fading light. Today we'll take a look at no more sorries and the imposter within. Sorries. Okay, here we go. Being mindful about when and where to apologize matters more than you might imagine. Sorry is often a difficult word to say, especially when it comes after a tricky situation or event. Yet in everyday life, it's repeated time and again. For the tiniest things, and for no real reason. You want to squeeze by someone blocking an aisle in the grocery store, so you say, "Sorry, could I get past, please?" You need to gain someone's attention and announce, "Sorry, can I just ask?" Or you arrive early for a meeting. Your colleague is already there, and you say, "I'm so sorry I kept you waiting." Sound familiar? All these scenarios have in common an apology that isn't necessary. You've done nothing wrong, and there's no need to make amends. It's perfectly reasonable to want to walk along a grocery store aisle, or to ask someone a question. So where's the need for an apology? You want to attract the person's attention in a polite and friendly manner, so hello. Or excuse me would suffice. Similarly, because a colleague decided to arrive extra early for a meeting, there's no need for you to behave as though you're running late. So why do people apologize unnecessarily, and does it matter? It matters because saying sorry isn't the same as saying hello or excuse me, which are neutral terms. Sorry is an apology. It's an admission that you're in the wrong. By using the word sorry, you aren't simply attracting a person's attention. You're apologizing for doing it, and that's different. It suggests you're apologizing for speaking up. Tip the habit. When someone apologizes, the reciprocal response is to accept their apology and forgive them. So in these everyday examples, what role does forgiveness have? What do you need to be forgiven for? For being in that place at that time? For being you? Although you don't feel sorry for what you're saying or doing, and there's no reason why you should, the recipient could conclude that you do. One of the ways to present yourself to others is with language. By being mindful of your words, you reduce the likelihood of being misunderstood and ensure the present. You present the real you. It can help to consider how thank you may be more appropriate. For example, you've had an exhausting day at work and you're venting to a friend about a challenging project. They've listened, offered sympathy, and been supportive. So you apologize for complaining and being negative. Everyone has tough days where they need to share how they feel. Is this a bad thing to do? Are you wrong to express how you feel? Is this a situation where you have something to apologize for? Friends listen and give the support they can. When a friend helps you, they don't do it expecting to be thanked. And they certainly don't expect an apology. Your appreciation is enough to make them feel glad they were able to be there for you. An apology, on the other hand, to make them feel as though they failed to help you. It helps to provide context and understanding to that situation. What transpired? A if you didn't do anything wrong, there's no need to seek absolution. Imagine the post-exhausting day scene again, but this time swap the word sorry. Alright, did I read that? I think I did. Shifting from a place of apology to a place of gratitude. Yes. Another example is when you realize that you've not replied to an email. You meant to respond immediately, but it slipped your mind and a few days have passed. You don't wish to appear rude by ignoring the fact the recipient may have been waiting for a reply. There are two options. Apologize for being slow to reply or thank them for their patience. Both recognize the delay, but the former begins the conversation negatively, whereas the latter is positive. There are many occasions where swapping the word sorry for thanks will change the dynamic of an interaction. Everyone has as much right as the next person to be heard and seen. You're allowed to feel what you're feeling, to express yourself, to take up space. You can still be kind, courteous, and compassionate to those around you. You can attract someone's attention with a smile and a friendly hello, or excuse me before making your request. Being the second person to arrive at a meeting doesn't make you late or in the wrong. You can thank a friend for listening, for their support, for being loyal. You can acknowledge another person's expectations with appreciation rather than apology. There are times when a sincere apology from the heart is necessary, when something wrong has been said or done. But there are many times when apologies aren't the best or even appropriate option. And that includes when you're being thoughtful, considerate, and a caring person. Image here is of two women. They're sitting on the word sorry. Sorry is printed in big gray letters, and there appear to be cracks in letters similar to the cracks that you'd see in maybe concrete. There are several plants going up around letters. One woman is offering the other a flower that is orange in coloration with green leaves. Behind them are several green hills. Some of these hills have trees on them that are sparse throughout. Overhead, there's an orange sky with a few white clouds spread out overhead. The upper right side of the horizon, there's an orange sun. The imposter within. Behind the facade of many a talented person lurks a conviction that they're fake. An inadequate, incompetent failure who's just lucked in and landed a great job, and a fear that they'll soon be exposed. Imposter syndrome is real. It's preventing too many people from fulfilling their potential. 15 years ago, I was accepted into a prestigious master's degree in creative writing at Glasgow University in Scotland. At welcome lunch to get to know the other students and staff, I discovered the institution had received 400 applications and I was one of 20 who had made the grade. I suddenly became gripped by the horrifying thought that there may have been a mistake. What if the university had meant to accept someone else on the course but had somehow sent the letter to me instead? As time went on, this feeling faded. It was the nature of the course to give and receive constructive feedback, and as fellow students commented favorably on my work, my confidence grew. In time, I believed Glasgow had meant to choose me after all. What is imposter syndrome? For me, those nagging feelings of doubt faded. But what if they hadn't? Imposter syndrome is defined by Dr. Valerie Young, author of The Secret Thoughts of Successful Women, as being when people have difficulty owning their accomplishments and dismiss them to factors outside of themselves, such as luck, help from others, or an if I can do it, anybody can attitude. The term imposter phenomenon was coined in the 1970s by clinical psychologists Dr. Suzanne Imes and Rose Clance. They conducted research with high-achieving women who nonetheless felt fraudulent that somehow their academic or career successes were unwarranted. The pair concluded that the phenomenon was more common in women or men with feminine qualities, although subsequent studies have suggested that it may be just as common in men. The fact is around 80% of people will be affected by the syndrome at some point in their lives. It can have devastating effects. Imposters feel terrified they'll be found out, and people will discover they're not as talented as they may appear. Many believe they are less able than their peers and need to make up for this by working extra hours. Alternatively, they fly under the radar and don't go for the job, promotion, or career of their dreams because they don't feel they're good enough to do it. In meetings, they don't ask questions for fear they will be revealed as quote-unquote stupid. But these hiding strategies can cause physical exhaustion, anxiety, and depression, as life isn't lived to the full, and the person feels their outward appearance of a talented, successful person is a facade. Valerie says imposter syndrome is common in fields where people's work is openly criticized, for example, academic or creative disciplines. Actor Kate Winslet and musician Lady Gaga are said to experience the syndrome, and late poet and civil rights campaigner Maya Angelou once said, "I have written 11 books, and each time I think, uh-oh, they're going to find out now. I've run a game on everybody, and they're going to find me out." How is it caused? Childhood can play a role. Valerie says children of perfectionist parents sometimes internalize a sense of failure. Per usual, I'll conclude today's mindfulness activity with my description of the image. There are two women, one in a dress that is orange with white lines across. There's another woman, she's wearing a white shirt and colorful pants with several plants on it. Pink flowers, orange flowers, small yellow flowers. She's wearing dark socks. Behind them is a blue background with several eyes all around them. Small eyes and big eyes. Eyes that are closed, eyes that are open. The woman in the dress has one arm on her hip and the other raised overhead. The other woman has one arm on her hip, the other down by her side. Should conclude my reading for today. Tomorrow I will have my mindfulness reading following my exercise stream. My personal belief about imposter syndrome, I think that for the most part, highly successful people may be subject to it. People that are probably more like me, ones that have experienced extreme levels of rejection in their careers, in their personal lives, will not experience imposter syndrome. It's only going to affect, in my belief, people that have a heightened level of achievement. People that have experienced a lot of success, or maybe a desire on their part to return some of that fame, fortune, maybe return to a point in time where life was simpler and easier for them, and expectations so that in their performance, achievements aren't quite. quite so high. I think that's pretty normal, as I've described. J.D. Salinger once wrote, "We are born back ceaselessly into the past, exposed against the current." And I'm of the belief that that is the case, because the past represents one of, if not the most idealistic times in our lives, a time when we didn't have quite so many challenges, quite so many responsibilities, quite so many obstacles to overcome. I'd say a lot of it does come down to perspective, identifying where you are in your present, and reflecting, contextualizing experiences you had, experiences you're having. And through consideration, find understanding. Like, what did this mean? Why did that happen? What could the consequences or implications of that be? And over time, with enough of these journeys of self-exploration, you'll be able to come to a newfound level of understanding yourself, your purpose, your place in the world, and in the greater universe. Alright, thank you all for watching. Thank you for your chat, your views, your follows. I say it all the time, your donations, everything helps and supports the stream, and I'm grateful for my audience. Hopefully some of these mindfulness exercises and activities are able to help you much the same way that my parents hoped that it would help me. Tomorrow, I do expect to have a somewhat long stream. I think I'll probably start about 3 or 4 p.m. in the afternoon, Pacific Standard Time. I will probably see if I can do... convection, guys. Finish out Return and maybe Hearthstone tomorrow. Rounding off with exercise and mindfulness. So thank you all for joining. I hope you have a good night. Stay sheltered, my storm champions, and I hope you all have a happy 4th of July.